place, be thinking of something that you could share that would give praise to God or show thanksgiving to God. A moment of testimony. I've done that for quite a long while. And it's good for us to give thanks and to think of the things for which we're obligated to be thankful. First Corinthians 11. Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to give thanks for safe travels for many family members that have been coming down here for visits and safe travels across the country, and the opportunity to be a witness to our families that are unsafe.
Amen. Yeah, and I'm thankful that you guys made it as well. It's always wonderful when you guys show up every year. So it's great. Amen. Yes, Lee?
I'd like to praise God for what he's done with Susanna this past year and making it through the surgery and all the follow-up surgeries and whatnot. And she's doing well, and praise God for that.
Yes, Mrs. Price?
This is my big church. God, we're working and answering so many prayers. Some that have been prayed for many years now, but once in particular, like Matt's dad, he accepted Christ.
And
he's now in heaven. Thank God for that. And then also how he's been working in the some people that I've worked with, and how he's brought them to truth about who he is, who God is. He's using them to share the gospel and witnessing in them. And even with simple things like jobs, we just saw my brother pass this huge exam that he had to take. He didn't have the time to prepare for it because working overtime and having the help that he had needed. Just thank you for answering prayer and caring about the little things.
We're thankful for opportunities. Had the opportunity yesterday morning to witness to a gentleman while getting gas. I think it was at a Safeway, I'm not sure, or a Speedway, something like that. And it you know, where it'll go from there, I'm not 100% sure. But it felt good to plant the seed and just kind of regular common conversation while pumping gas and talking to someone. Also, it was a good reminder to always have tracks with you no matter where you are. And really, really was grateful for that opportunity.
Yeah.
Really was grateful.
Isn't it amazing God sends people to you to preach the gospel to?
Yeah.
I mean, we're supposed to go, but sometimes it seems like God's like, yeah, go, here you go. You know, it's such a witness that the Holy Spirit's with us and that God is doing things that are unbelievably beyond our imagination. Anyone else? Yes, Mrs. Price? You already had your turn. All right.
I'm really, really thankful for the people that God's brought here this year. It's an encouragement to see all the people that He's brought to us.
Our millennials especially.
Just to hear their stories and the testimony.
Randy, go ahead.
Yeah, I want to always it's my thanks all the time. I just want to thank the Lord for the privilege of being entrusted with the gospel.
Yeah.
And to have all the opportunities, as people have said already, the opportunities He gives us every day to be ambassadors for Christ and to, like you said, you know, the Holy Spirit, you know, I feel like He nudges you to certain people you might not even think of it, and all of a sudden you just say, yeah, something tells me I just spoke with that person. There's a reason why that person crossed my path, so I want to give them the gospel, whether they know it or not. You know, I don't know their hearts, so you know, like I said, it could be a seed planted or a plant watered, but no, God gets an increase. So.
Yeah, amen. Yeah. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Charlie?
No, just that God saw fit to extend my dad's life and my grandma's life so far this year. So they're a lot more introspective. They're not saved yet, but just that they're a lot more open, I guess you could say, sensitive to
amen.
Preaching.
Pray they get saved soon. Yeah, boy, for God to sustain your life so you can trust Jesus is a miracle. Yeah. chance, Luke. You know, I just, many times, there, you know, you just go on and on and on and on about the things that you're grateful for and the amazing things that you've seen. I have seen in my lifetime, I've seen God just do things that are a dream. I don't know how else to put it. Just, you know, you just dream about being involved in the Lord's work and ministry and seeing God do the things that, you know, only God could do. And I feel like that's, like I get to live a dream. And I don't know how else to say that. I was thinking as we were driving back from our Miami Beach service this afternoon, you know, who else gets to go to Miami Beach? There's people that want a vacation there, and we get to go to church there. You know, and what a miracle it is that, you know, we've got a church that's been holding services for 2 years, and we've got people, it looks as though, you know, that may be lined up to be the leadership in that ministry. And I'm always just amazed that the Lord gives vision, and when you just are obedient to whatever the vision the Lord's placed in you, you begin to take steps of faith, that in the end you look back and you just can't believe what God did. You know, and the thing that you know, the connecting thing is that God told you to do something, and it couldn't work, it wouldn't work, it was impossible, and then the Lord did a miracle. And, you know, that's what I feel about this church, about our Marathon Church, our church in Miami Beach, and, the people that the Lord brings. You know, the turnover here is heartbreaking. It literally breaks my heart every time somebody moves away, and yet the Lord just brings us new people to minister to, just new opportunity. You know, it's so tough watching people move away. You know, they get plugged in, they start to fit in the church and belong, and then next thing you know, hey, we're moving. And that's tough. But the fact that God just provides it by way of opportunity, and I think in many ways keeps you from being stagnant, has to keep you really real about reaching people. And this ministry is just a dream. The people that we have in our church, you I'm talking about, are just... And it's just, I always feel it's just such an incredible privilege to even know the people that go to our church, far less have the privilege of pastoring them. And God's just very, very good to us. And been very good to our ministry. So then I guess if I were to summarize that all, I would say that on a day like January 1st, when you have so many unknowns, you know, you have 364 days of opportunity left. It's amazing that on January 1st, God has just poured vision into me. You know, where I can't even tell you all the things that, you know, I believe that the Lord wants to do and wants us to do as a ministry. You just think, man, wouldn't it be terrible to not have the Holy Spirit and to not have a purpose and a reason to live and a direction and all those things? What a wonderful thing. What a privilege it is to have that. Sometimes we have to stop and just reflect and be thankful that we're not like those that are lost, that are trying to find out what life's about. We're actually able to live life and know what it's about. What a privilege that is. What a wonderful thing it is. I'm also thankful that Charlie almost has a girlfriend. So.
Poor Charlie.
1 Corinthians chapter 11. The message that I will preach this evening is simple. You've probably heard it before. Not the message, but the passage of Scripture, which is where the message comes from. And yet it's probably the most frightening, most important, heaviest message that a Christian could preach. And it's so important to realize not just the importance of the Lord's Supper, but the weightiness of the matter. The truth of the matter is, this evening, as I get ready to preach tonight, normally I like to mess around and joke and say things about the closest we're going to get is talking about Charlie having a girlfriend. But the reality of it is that a message like the Lord's Supper, there just isn't really any levity here in this passage of Scripture. It's a somber, serious moment, actually. And it's an important one. Sometimes I think, as pastor, that I would like to be more regular about having Lord's Supper services. I don't have an objection. I said this morning that we do things a certain way because in the Scripture, the Bible says, as often as you eat it, Jesus said, this do in remembrance of me. And so the idea, as often as, is simply how the language is put. In other words, when you do this. And so some churches say, well, as often as, and oftentimes every time they get together. Matter of fact, I see that precedent. I do see it in Acts that oftentimes the believers are coming together to take the Lord's Supper. And yet in 1 Corinthians 11, we find out that that had led to some dangerous behavior. And so I would say it's probably, possibly, too often that they were partaking of the Lord's Supper. I am afraid to do something monthly or quarterly or annually simply because I don't want anything that has to do with the Lord's Supper to become routine. And so if we do it quarterly or monthly or weekly, I think it's a routine. I think we ought to be prompted by the Holy Spirit of God. And that way we're led to do this. It isn't just a matter of, well, this is what we always do. And I'm not saying you can't do something in a routine way and do it right. That's not what I'm implying, but I'm just saying I think this is important that we take the Lord's Supper very, very seriously as a church and understand it. When we partake of the Lord's Supper, the explanation that we'll see in the text is that we are looking at or remembering the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's what makes it such a somber moment. I'll be honest with you, there are periods of my life when I can't handle any more grief. In other words, 2 years ago my sister died, and 10 people I know died in 2015. I mean, just 10 people that I knew personally, was kind of close to, died in 2015. And I'll be honest with you, I got to a place where I didn't want to hear about it. You tell me, well, this friend you went to college with died, and people want to talk about or ask details or whatever. I just couldn't. I didn't want to discuss it because it just hurt too much. There's just too much grief to it, and you can only handle so much. You know, God gives you grace for what you have to handle, but you're only physically capable of so much. Where I think it would just crush you, maybe kill you. Is what it feels like it would do. And so those things are somber and serious. And when we look at the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, I am not ever one to emphasize the physical suffering of Jesus versus the actual reality that Jesus became sin. In other words, the reality that Christ became sin, our sin, and God turned His back on His Son, is far greater than the fact that Jesus was tortured. When you see, and I don't like them, I've never gone on purpose to see one, but when you see a passion play, I don't like passion plays at all. First of all, I'm bothered that anyone would try to act the part of Christ. I'm not criticizing anyone else who differs from me on this, but I am troubled. I couldn't do it. I couldn't act the part of Christ. I couldn't play that part. And to me, it would just you just don't have enough humility if you think you can act the part of Christ and try to, you know, people try to project their impression of what Jesus was. And I just think, I don't want your impression, and nobody wants mine, of who Jesus is, because Jesus was God. He was God's Son. And, I'm not sure that a sinner could represent that even as an act very well. So I'm for reading about the death, the burial, for preaching it, but I'm not for acting it out. I'm not criticizing what anyone else has done except for Mel Gibson. I'm against that Passion of Christ movie. I am criticizing that, in case you're wondering. Never watched it. Won't watch it. But when people watched, I remember this was a 2004 Mel Gibson did the Passion of Christ. I think it was around 2004. My sister did some of the art, I believe, for that set and so forth on it. But I believe it was in 2004. And I remember having a discussion with some people asking about whether you think this is a good thing or a bad thing. But I remember talking to people that had gone to watch the Passion, and they said that in the theater after it ended, after the movie ended, and I don't even know how it ended. I've never watched it. I haven't read the script enough. I'm just bothered enough. There were some things back then I'd read up on that bothered me more than I'm bothered today, because I've forgotten about it, so I'm not bothered about it anymore. But, you know, there were some things about it I was told that it was so vivid, such a real, I guess, depiction of the crucifixion, that the theater was just silent. when the movie was over, people just sat there, like, you know, in shock. And, you know, some people said, well, that's a great thing. You know, people need to know what Jesus suffered. And I'm fine with people knowing that Jesus physically, humanly suffered. I do believe, however, that other people have suffered. In other words, I could read to you Fox's Book of Martyrs, and it's not bedtime reading, folks. It's not something that you go to sleep on, you know, and it's a serious thing. I make it a habit as often as I can to visit Holocaust museums. I do because I think it's important that we don't forget what we're capable of, what people are capable of, when they don't fear God and when they don't have the value for human life that God has. And so I try to visit Holocaust museums pretty frequently. I think it's good for me. And I have to say that some of the things that were done to unbelieving Jews were so terrible that it make you sick. In other words, they suffered. And so what I would say about the Lord's Supper is that it isn't the physical suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ that is so sobering and such an important thing. It's important for us to remember Jesus Christ did physically come, that He did physically live without sin, and He physically died. But the reality, the injustice of the death of Christ was the innocence of the Lord Jesus. The fact that Jesus never sinned, and yet He died for my sin. And I'll be honest with you, I can only handle guilt so much, but every time I reflect on the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm reminded that I'm guilty. I'm reminded of my guilt. And I don't feel good about that. And so it's a weighty, heavy matter to me. I don't know how often. I don't think I could physically handle having the Lord's Supper on a daily basis. I just don't think I could do it. I feel like it would take a toll. I'm sure my hair would gray, and my blood pressure would rise, and physical things that happen under stress would happen to me. And I'll just be honest with you, Lord's Supper is stressful for me. It's rather stressful for me, and it's stressful for me because of my understanding of 1 Corinthians and chapter 11. So let's look at it, and let's see some of the reasons why this is such an important matter and why we ought to take it so seriously. Paul, in the entire letter to this church, is correcting problems that are causing division. And Paul has just said in verse 18, he said, well, let's look at verse 17. He said, now in this I declare unto you, I praise you not, that ye come together not for the better, but for the worse. And that's, that verse by itself has made a very, very major impact on me. I don't know about you. As a pastor, when you're responsible, I am the worship leader in our church. That term worship leader kind of cracks me up because it doesn't mean to most people what it means to me. I'm not the guy that dances on stage. I'm the guy that leads the worship in our church. I'm responsible to God for what happens. I'm the leader of this ministry. So I'm the one that, according to Scripture, has the oversight of the ministry. And that's my appointment. That's what I am as pastor. It's the office that I fill, and it's a serious thing. And the idea that what I'm responsible to lead could result in people being worse off after they came than they were beforehand is frightening, to be quite frank. It's frightening to me, and I don't know if you've ever thought about this. Every person ought to preach enough to understand the importance of preaching. You know, somebody can go to hell if they've come to hear the gospel and they don't hear it from a preacher. People, I believe, do go to hell because they come to hear the gospel and don't hear it from a preacher. And so I think that that needs to be the weight of the message, ultimately, is to help people to understand that their sin has separated them from God. And that because of that separation from them and God, they are in need of a Savior. And that Jesus died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, and that they could freely receive Him. You've got to communicate that to people. And I just sometimes think, what if people go to hell because of my preaching? What if people go to hell because of my preaching? That's a serious thing. And Paul begins this text by kind of helping this church at Corinth to realize that you could meet in that church. And when you come together, you don't come together for, you come together not for the better, but for the worse. Literally, after this church convenes and fellowships, they're worse off than before they came. So you ask the question, well, what in the world could you do in church that would be worse than not going? This is a little bit of an aside, but some of you remember when we did our Sunday school series several years ago, 10 Things Every Christian Should Know. You remember I challenged everybody that if you could test out, in other words, if you got a 95% or higher on the test, then don't bother coming to Sunday school for the next 10 weeks. Go out and do something better. You know, go invite some people to church or something during the Sunday school hour, or sleep in, or eat breakfast, or do something, whatever, because if you're not going to learn anything, what's the point being there? School is to teach. It's for you to learn. If you come with an attitude that you can't learn, or if you can't be taught anything because you know more than is being taught, then, you know, make good use of your time. There's nothing the Bible says you have to be in Sunday school class. Now, I think people should be in Sunday school class. That wasn't the point, but my point was that I wanted our Sunday school to be worth people's time. I want people to come and be no better off for having been there than if they had stayed at home, or being worse off for having been there than if they'd stayed at home. Rather a serious matter. You know, so if you get the tone, I just whenever I go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I'll tell you what, I'm not laughing my way through this passage of Scripture. It's got me sitting up, paying attention, and a little bit afraid. And I think that's the proper attitude to begin a Lord's Supper service. I think it's a proper response toward it. Paul said there were heresies in the church. Heresies are variances of belief, variances of doctrine or opinion. And he said so in verse 18, for first of all, when you come together, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it, for there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved among you, which they are approved, may be made manifest among you. And here Paul is going to take sides. He said there's those that are approved, the things that are correct, the things that are right, and I want that to be manifested among you. You have different opinions about it, and I'm telling you what is right. Aren't you glad God doesn't say figure it out, or solve it yourself, or whoever's most intelligent, or presents the best argument? That's what they do in seminary. A bunch of guys, not in all seminaries, but a lot of seminaries, a lot of professors, present their viewpoint, and whoever can present it the most intelligently is, you know, given a medal or something like that, I think is what they do. Actually, they put in a book, four views on or five views on this. You read this guy's view and this guy's view and this guy's view. I remember reading books like that and thinking, well, doesn't God have an opinion about it? In other words, the weight of a matter is, well, I really think this, and the guy explains what he thinks, and you listen to it, and you're like, oh, okay, I see where you're coming from. And another guy explains it, well, that's why I don't agree with this guy. He gives his, oh, okay, I see where you're coming from. And then everybody gives their views. And then, you know, you're supposed to pick one of these guys. Well, I found out a long time ago, God's very opinionated. So you can just dispense with those fellows and find out what God says, and you'll be all right without having to read the book on it. And I'm not against reading the book. I'm oftentimes reading four views on, five views on, that sort of thing. But you better know what God thinks. And I found out that they start off by saying, well, the Bible says in this verse, but over here, and I just think, well, let's just forget the but over here. Let's just stop what the Bible says and draw our conclusion there. That'd be good enough. I remember being in seminary one time and having a man in seminary asking a professor a question, and he said something to the effect of, he was asking a question, and the teacher just gave him a verse that directly answered the question. And he said, that's the answer everybody gives. And I said, that's the correct answer. In other words, he wanted a complicated, backward approach, a way to get at the same thing from another perspective. And I'll be honest with you, I don't have any use for that at all. Listen, truth is truth, and when it's simply stated, it ought to be simply understood and left alone. I don't have to, you know, you can, just because you reject the simple explanation, it doesn't give me a burden of responsibility to convince you from an intellectual or complicated perspective. There's a simple answer, it's simply answered, period. And that's good enough. And a lot of false doctrine comes from, you know, long explanations. And then the long explainers citing each other and writing books about what each other said. And then you read the Bible and you're like, well, they're just all wrong. I mean, the Bible is a book that's meant to be understood. So Paul said here, he said there are divisions, there are heresies, differences or variances in belief or opinion. But he said, I'm just telling you, there's going to be some that are approved. In other words, I'm going to tell you what's right. And so he said in verse 20, when you come together, therefore, into one place, here's the statement. I mean, you want an outline? There it is. This is not to eat the Lord's Supper. This is not to eat the Lord's Supper. Okay? Same as now, the responsibility to feed yourself is your own. And if you can't do a good job at it, learn how. You know, I mean, I don't know what else to say. Every man ought to be able to make chili. Every man ought to be able to bake a pie. So don't come around here expecting me to make your chili or bake your pie. You know, you bring your own chili, your own pie, and we'll share. I'll eat some of yours, eat some of mine. But don't come here and say, you know, I want to eat yours because I don't know how. The idea here is that if you're needy or if you're hungry, this is not the Lord's Supper, and it had become that. It literally had become where they had, you know, they had bread, and they had a cup, and they ate in the tradition that they ate. They passed the bread, and break the bread, and there were people that were, you know, getting good chunks of bread, good portions of bread. Why are you doing that? Well, because I'm hungry. I need a big piece, you know. And people, they were saying, but this is not about eating. You know, well, we're eating, aren't we? Why can't it be about eating? So Paul here says, this is not about eating. He said, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. As a child, I used to wonder, why so small? Why is the bread so small? You know, it's not even a bite. Well, because it's not to eat. In other words, that's the correct approach on it. There's no prescribed size in the Bible. There isn't a, you know, quarter inch or so many millimeters or this percentage of a cubit or this weight. No, it's I believe the standard here is small enough that it's not food. Okay? And the argument here is that in aiding, everyone taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry, and another is drunken. I think we had a fellowship one time and had a lot of food here. I believe we had chicken wings one time, had a bunch of chicken wings, and I used this illustration. I think there was a big, either that or I imagine using this illustration, or imagine there was a big chicken wing. I can't remember. It either happened or I believe it happened, one or the other. So, there was a tray of chicken wings. I believe it was actually that way, and there was one really big one. You ever go through a line at a buffet style and you're behind somebody, and several trays ahead of you, you know, in the meat section, we're not talking about lettuce, you know, the big piece of lettuce, but in the meat section, there's, you know, a rib that's got a lot of meat on it. Or there's a chicken wing that's bigger than the other chicken wings that's there. And when you see it, you're like, I'm going to get that chicken wing. That looks like, you know, you see one that looks good. It looks really good. You know, or maybe, you know, you're getting cinnamon rolls and you're thinking, I'm going to get the one in the middle. You know, I don't want the crusty outside one. I'm going to get a cinnamon roll from the center of the cinnamon roll thing. And one of the things I realized a long time ago is that I'm not the only one that thinks like that. Because whoever's in front of me always gets my chicken wing. Or, and sometimes I want to say, hey, that was mine. Back there, I said to myself I was going to get that one. But the problem was that person was up there and they said to themselves, and everybody, the Bible says in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper. The idea is that you may be polite, and I hope you are. I hope we're not a bunch of selfish cannibals. And you may defer. You may give somebody, say, well, I like that one, so I'm going to give that to somebody else because I want to honor them or show them that, you know, hey, I want this, but I want you to have it. So it's a way to defer it. But the fact of the matter is there is an inherent selfishness in us or an inherent desire to have the best for ourselves. And if we could be sneaky and underhanded about it, all the better. You know, if we could make you think, you know, that one in the corner looks real good. Well, I'm glad I took that one in the corner. I got the one I want. You know, in other words, make them think they got the best one, but actually, you know, you're not so dissatisfied with the one that you got because, you know, it's the one you wanted. We're that way. That's our nature. And you're sitting there smiling because you know you're that way. You know, if we were going down the row and we're eating food, you'd want the best piece. Maybe not the biggest piece, but the best piece for yourself. And Paul says, we're not eating because when we eat, we all get the best for us. He says, this and honest about it as he possibly can. He said, in eating, each taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry and another is drunken. And so then you have a guy, you say, I'm not here for the food, I'm here for the juice or the wine. It's oinos. The word is translated wine, but it means fruit of the vine. It's not alcoholic. The Bible says about things that are alcoholic, it says wine's a mocker and strong drink is raging. The Bible does make a distinction between wine and strong drink, and that's not the discussion this evening, but that's why we don't drink corrupted wine when we partake of the Lord's Supper. But maybe one person says, well, I'm more about the cup than I am about the bread. And some of us are that way, aren't we? Some of us would rather drink something than eat something, or eat something than drink something. And Paul said that's not what it's about. We're not here because we want to eat, or we want to drink, or we want the best piece. We're here because we are remembering the Lord's body and his blood. And the argument continues. He says, what? Have you not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God and shame them that have not? And the idea here is, if everybody is different and you make a meal out of it, there are going to be some people that really enjoy the meal, and some people are going to be, it's going to be, you know, common fare. And you just don't want that. It would be a real problem if we came and had the Lord's Supper on the basis of taste, preference, and, you know, what we prefer background-wise, or how hungry we are. You know what it's like to be hungry, don't you? And when I'm hungry, I'll tell you something, anything's good. Anything tastes good. Matter of fact, anything's good even when I'm not hungry sometimes. But, you know, I grew up in a family, I'm not kidding about this, I grew up in a family where you were very thankful to have food on the table. And you ate it. And you ate all the food. All the food was eaten. And you could have eaten more when it was gone. And so we didn't have, I don't like that. That never happened in our house. Nobody ever said, I don't like that. My parents would have killed us if we never said that. But aside from that, you know, we were glad to have what we could have. It was very different how I behaved at a buffet. Very rarely we'd get to go to a place called Bonanza. It was sort of like a Golden Corral before there was Golden Corral. And the way we behaved at Bonanza was different than the rich kids. The rich kids ate food. We got our money's worth. My dad'd say, kids, get your money's worth. We got our money's worth. I promise you, it cost them more to feed us than what we paid them to eat, especially because we would go only when kids ate free. And so we definitely got our money's worth. So kids, get your money's worth, you know. And I remember seeing kids there just like getting food like it wasn't any big deal. Just eat whatever you wanted to and all you wanted to eat. And hearing them say, I don't like that. And I thought, man, what's wrong with you, kid? I mean, we were just like, man, pile it all on, eat everything, you know, get your plate, ice cream, you know, smuggle gummy bears out in your pockets. Y'all never done that. Get what you can, you know. In other words, the attitude, it says, have you not houses to eat in, but it says, or despise ye the church of God. In other words, some people there would look at other people if it were a meal and say, well, you think that's something? In other words, it almost becomes a class or a separation thing in the body at a time when they're focusing on the fact that because of fellowship in the Lord Jesus Christ, they're one. Matter of fact, we know that in the early church that there would have been servants who were actually pastors. And the people they pastored would have been their masters. And so this idea here would be to behave in such a way that if you make it a meal, all of a sudden you have servants and you have masters. And you have people that aren't the same. And this is about the body and blood of Jesus Christ being shed and us all being on even ground as a result of that. And so that was one of the problems of the Lord's Supper and making a meal out of it instead of making it a simple snapshot or remembrance of what Christ did when he suffered and died. Then he said, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. And the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. Now this is verse 23 by itself. Is a fascinating study that we won't make this evening. I'll suffice it to explain and say this. Paul, he said, whether in the body or out of the body, he could not tell, but he was caught up to the third heaven. He had an experience with the Lord Jesus. And here he's referencing that he wasn't at that Last Supper with the other 12 apostles, but the Lord Jesus told him what the Lord's Supper was all about. In other words, he didn't hear about the Lord's Supper from Peter and from the rest of the disciples. He heard about the Lord's Supper from Jesus saying, this is what we did for the Lord's Supper, and giving him a one-on-one personal instruction course. That's interesting, isn't it? That's is interesting, a little bit of an understatement. I think it's just one of those nuggets in the scripture where you can learn some things if you pay attention. Verse 24, when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. So, Lord's Supper is not to eat the Lord's body, it's not to eat the Lord's Supper. It's not to consume it for your fleshly appetite. And it is to remember the Lord's body. This has deep doctrinal significance and simple doctrinal significance. The fact of the matter is that it is very, very important for us to understand that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, that he was fully God and he was fully man. And friend, when Philippians says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself in the likeness of sinful flesh. Boy, I just butchered that, didn't I? It was found in fashion as a man. Yeah, okay, so Jesus, who was God, became a man, and not only that, but a servant of men. The idea of Jesus Christ coming as a king is such a serious demotion that it ought to make us stop with awe and wonder at it. In other words, if Jesus came to the cleanest, most expensive, most elaborate palace on earth, it's a serious demotion for him to be the king as a man versus being creator God. In other words, the condescension is the proper term. The condescension of Christ to become a man ought to make us stop and say, whoa. So when we remember the Lord's body, remember that Jesus Christ came like a man with a body that was susceptible like man's. And that he was tempted like we are, yet without sin. And so there's deep doctrinal significance, and there's also simple doctrinal significance. Do we get it? In other words, the fact that Jesus came and his body came is significant, but it's also significant that his body was broken for us. When they break his legs on the cross, when they thrust a spear into his side, when they drove the nails through his hands and through his feet, his body was broken. Because mine should have been. And so the significance is that Christ condescended to come as a man. And that is unjust. It isn't the way it ought to be. But secondly, that he suffered as a man. And then the third thing that we see is in verse 25. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. New Testament. Testament is a testimony or is a covenant. And Jesus' blood is a covenant. And testament, of course, we know doesn't have force until the death of the testator. In other words, God's promise that Christ would come could be believed on the basis of the character of God. But the finality and significance of the cross was that the covenant was enforced. My great aunt, I've told this story several times, but I think it's a good one. My great aunt keeps changing her will. We got a visitor, and I said, Daniel, my brother, you know him, most of you, was home for, I think, 3 or 4 months. And Aunt Margie called him. She said, she's 99, she'll be 100. Is it March, Melissa? February. Okay, 100. She'll be 100 next month. She called. She said, Daniel! And he said, hi, Aunt Margie. She said, did you know that I stopped driving my car? I sold it. And he said, yeah, I knew that, Margie. Oh, I thought you didn't know I sold my car because you haven't come by to see me. I thought you thought I wasn't home. She didn't really think that, but Aunt Margie's rather, if why haven't you come and visited me? You know, I should write you out of the will for that. you'll get, you know, you don't visit Aunt Margie, she'll write you out. And pretty much everybody but Daniel's out. You know, I live in Florida, so forget me, you know. So my point is this, who knows who's in? I don't mean to be morbid, but who knows who's in until the will and testament has force to it. It can be changed as long as the person whose testament it is or whose will it is still living. And so when it says this cup is the new testament in my blood, the force of it is that this will have force because of my death, because of my blood being shed. We know from Leviticus and really all the Old Testament, the life of the flesh is in the blood. And so this is a testament that Jesus' life was given for ours. So again, the force of the understanding here is significant, isn't it? It's heavy. I mean, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. And so it's not a matter of, well, you know, the grape juice is a little thin tonight. Somebody diluted it with water. We're not sampling and tasting. We are realizing that Christ's blood was shed. And that the promises of God from eternity past have been enforced through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I mean, the blood means God didn't just say it, He did it. His Son was judged in our place. Our sin penalty was paid for, and it is finished. When we partake of the cup, then we are realizing that this is the testament which is enforced of His blood. It's often in verse 26, as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till He come. And here's another reminder. I have this underlined in my Bible. Ye do show the Lord's death till He come. Another purpose of the Lord's Supper. First purpose is not to eat the Lord's, It is to help us to remember the Lord Jesus. It is to remind us that the testament is enforced and to remember the Lord Jesus by that. But it's also a reminder, not only that Jesus died, but that Jesus is coming again. Tonight, I had discussions with people that told me they weren't coming to service. And they said, well, I'm not coming to service because of the Lord's Supper. And they said, you're not going to argue with that, are you? The person told me, you're not going to argue with that, are you? And I said, yeah. If you can't partake of the Lord's Supper, get right. Because it's all about fellowship. That's the point. In other words, you do show the Lord's death till He come. You know, Jesus is coming, we better be ready. In order to be ready means that we need to be in fellowship. And incidentally, that's why it's kind of important to start the year by having a Lord's Supper service. To say, hey, listen, let's get off on the right foot. Listen, I'm not saying all of us finished well last year. I'm saying we better start well. We better get things well. It's good to have a checkup sometimes to tell you things aren't right. And that's one of the things the Lord's Supper service is for. In other words, Jesus is coming. And friend, I'll just tell you something. I don't want to be like those that are in the darkness that day should overtake them as a thief. I want to get up in the morning the day that Jesus comes and say, I've been singing, this could be the year that He comes all day today. But I want to think, I bet Jesus is coming today. I would love to have just said it to somebody. I think Jesus is probably coming today. Dr. Joel Molinex, one of the teachers at Pensacola Christian College, is on Twitter. And almost every day he puts, he's probably coming today or something like that on Twitter. I love that. I just love that because that's the way a Christian who's in fellowship ought to be. Now, okay, you know, Jesus is probably coming, you know, better finish this message up so we can be done when He gets here, you know, because He's probably coming soon. That's the way God wants us to live. And you have to be in fellowship to think that and to live like that and to believe that. So one of the purposes of the Lord's Supper is to show the Lord's death till He come. And so it is not only a demonstration of, just like baptism, that I identify and I remember the fact that Jesus died, was buried, rose again, But it's also a reminder that I believe that he's coming again. It is more than troubling that Bible-believing churches today are filled with people who are rejecting the imminent return of the Lord Jesus. They believe we're going to go through suffering and usher in the tribulation. They make nothing of God's covenant with Israel in the 70th week of Daniel and so forth. But it's troublesome to me, and ought to be troublesome. It's just it's a problem because it takes away the force of the imminence of Christ's return. Jesus is coming, a friend. Probably is today. Could be tonight. You're not going to finish your vacation. Jesus is coming. And I'm telling you, you want to have Lord Jesus come and say, I thought you were coming. Wouldn't that be a great way? In other words, isn't it a surprise? It's a, I knew it. Knew you were coming. I was thinking that just now. And it looks like he is. Looks like he's going to come right away, folks. And that's one of the things that partaking of the Lord's Supper shows us. Then we have the warning. I've spent a lot of time here in times past, so we'll read it, understand it, and do a simple explanation before. In verse 27, wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Simply put, an individual who isn't careful to be in fellowship, to properly partake of the Lord's body, is going to be held accountable for being flippant about the Lord's body and His blood. I mean, this is to casual. I mean, it ties up the whole idea of taking the Lord's Supper like it's a meal, and like you're trying to get the bread first or the drink first. This makes such a mockery out of the actual reality that God became man, that the one who knew no sin died for sin, His body was broken for us, His blood was shed, and the substitution of it was for us, and we are sitting around being frivolous and flippant as though it makes no difference at all, and that makes us guilty. In other words, He took our guilt and our shame, and here we are acting as though He didn't. And if we act as though He didn't, what does that make us? Still guilty. In verse 28, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. There are many places in the Scripture to understand this. It's popular among Christians to have support confession groups where men confess their sins and their shortcomings to one another. But the reality of it is that we ought to confess these things to the Lord Jesus Christ. Confession isn't to a man. Confession is to God. Forgiveness isn't from man. Forgiveness is from God. I'm not anti-accountability groups, but I've found that oftentimes it's just men swapping guilt stories and saying, yeah, you're normal, and that sort of thing. And when the reality of it is that God has told us that if we examine ourselves, we won't be judged. And this is another passage of Scripture that supports that. In verse 28, let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. This evening, I will not examine you. I'll simply warn you. Don't take of the Lord's Supper unworthily, or you'll get sick or die. You know, you ever have somebody, when you tell them to do or not to do something, they say, well, what'll happen? You'll get sick or die. That's what will happen. Look at the Scripture in verse 30. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Sleep means to be dead. And for if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. I could preach every one of these verses and preach a message, and that's why this is taking so long to just get through this short passage of Scripture. But here we find an opportunity. If we would judge ourselves, the Bible says we should not be judged. But when we're judged, we're chastened of the Lord. Have you ever been deserving of chastening? You ever done wrong and God should chasten you? Judge yourself and avoid chastening. I love God's Get Right Free program. You know, I shouldn't even put it that way because maybe it sounds a little bit like we're making light of it or something. But the reality of it is that if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But if we don't confess our sins, God knows about them anyway. And that's when chastening comes in. And notice the word chastening here is used. The idea of chastening is always an evidence of sonship, that you are God's child. And Christian, I'll just be honest with you tonight, if you're not right with the Lord, and you haven't been seriously dealt with by God, you've got to get out of jail free pass, and I'm not being silly about it. In other words, one of the reasons to start the year by saying, hey, if you're not right, get right, is that literally God is so infinitely merciful, so gracious and ready to forgive, that you could call out for His mercy and receive it simply for the asking. But you have to acknowledge that you need it. And a lot of us are not only so prideful, but we are so cavalier or so ostentatious about our state of being. Do you know, Christians sometimes are proud of the fact that they're not right with the Lord. You ever meet a Christian that says, well, I'll just be honest about it, as though there's some virtue in being honest about being a scoundrel? Sort of like the homeless guy that puts up a sign, not going to lie, I just want beer. Well, everybody knows that, but it doesn't make you any better than the other guys. Shame on you anyway. In other words, you know, as though there's some virtue in a guy saying, yeah, you know what? I'm going to wreck my life. But I'm going to say I'm going to wreck my life instead of pretending that I'm not. In other words, I don't have shame about it, is what he's really saying. And he ought to be ashamed. He ought to be ashamed enough to get right. That's the point of it. And as a Christian, this evening, I would urge you to partake of the Lord's Supper worthily. In other words, there's no virtue in saying, well, there are some things in my life that I haven't taken care of, and so I'm not worthy to partake of the Lord's Supper, so I'm not going to. Well, friend, that's the safe maneuver, but it isn't the correct one. Got what I'm saying? In other words, you're not escaping chastening. You're just not going to get killed. But it'd be better to get right back into fellowship with a gracious and merciful God, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? And that's the point. Verse 33, wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. So the idea of tarrying one for another means to let others be before you. You'll notice in a little bit when I have Brother Charlie and Brother Lee come and help with the Lord's Supper, that we serve each other, we serve you, we serve each other, and then when everybody has been served, then we partake at the same time. And the reason for that is that it isn't who's first. The idea is we want everyone else to be before us. We want to serve each other. And that's the appropriate way to do it. So it isn't, pass the cup around and, you know, everybody gets their turn. The idea is let it wait for everyone else. And so that's the idea of tarry one for another. And then, in conclusion, he said, if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that you come not together unto condemnation. And he said, the rest will I set in order when I come. And so evidently, there were things that the Holy Spirit didn't think applied to any other church than the church at Corinth, that Paul was going to have to set in order. That's what that indicates. Aren't you glad that the very same things that all men deal with, God's just put it in the Scripture because it's written to us. And this, you could say, was written to the church at Corinth, but friend, it's not a personal letter. It's an open letter, and it's open because it involves us. And the same way they're to partake of the Lord's Supper is the same way we're going to. Now, we may be idiosyncratic. We may have some things that are, you know, things that only we do, but the truth is that people are all the same. They're made of the same sinful flesh and have the same sinful, prideful notions. And the things that ought to be set straight have been, I believe, from the Word of God. So we're going to finish this portion of our service now with a word of prayer. And then we're going to begin the Lord's Supper service. Father, I pray that we would be reminded of the importance of the death of Christ. Lord, we're not here to eat. We're not here to drink. We're not here to be first. We're here to remember that your body was broken, that your blood was shed, and that you are true to your word, your promise. Father, because of Jesus Christ, those of us who were afar off have been made near. nigh to you. Our ability to pray this evening is because of Jesus and the work of the cross. Our ability to find forgiveness when we've fallen and sinned is because of the work of the cross. So we acknowledge these things this evening. We ask that in the time that we spend tonight, as we look on the truth that your body and blood was broken for us, I pray that you would help us by your presence being in this service to deal with ourselves, Lord. Help our minds where we wouldn't remember that we have sin, to remember the sin so that we could judge ourselves. We thank you for the cross and for forgiveness. We thank you in Jesus' name. Now in a minute, I'm going to ask Brother Lee and Charlie to come and help me with passing out and serving the elements of the Lord's Supper tonight. Before we do that, I do want to have a little bit of time where we could take and examine ourselves. And my recommendation would be, we announced the Lord's Supper service so that you could examine yourself before you came this evening. But it's always good to take a look and to be honest about the things that you know, and then to desire the Holy Spirit of God to show you those things that perhaps you may have not taken as seriously as God wants you to, or whether those things you've even forgotten about that God would call to your remembrance. So let's take a moment of time and let's deal with ourselves and take that portion of the service where we judge ourselves. And the benefit again is that because of that we'll not be judged. So let's take a bit of time, and then I will we'll begin our Lord's Supper portion of our service.